morning.
Good morning.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
It's a good day. I kind of put together, just in the past 15 minutes, due to some unforeseen events. Hopefully you like it. So yeah, it's good. All right. Matthew chapter 20, verses 17 to 19. And Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples apart in the way, and said unto them, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and unto the scribes. And they shall condemn him to death, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge, and to crucify him, and the third day he shall rise again. Mark 16, verses 5 through 7. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he said unto them, Be not affrighted, ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold, the place where they laid him. But go your way, tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him, and he said unto you. Luke 24, verses 3 to 6. And they entered in, and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid, and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee. Today we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. His resurrection completed everything that he had spoken of to that time and everything that was prophesied. With his resurrection, we were given access to all his blessings, all his power, to his Holy Spirit.
Amen.
He was raised, so will we.
Yes.
1 Corinthians 6, verse 14. And God hath both raised up the Lord, and he will also raise up us by his own power. We were born again to a living hope. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy had begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We were also given authority to speak as he himself was speaking over things. Ezekiel 37, verses 1 through 5. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones and caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. And he said unto me, Prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus said the Lord God unto these bones, Behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
So let's continue to celebrate his resurrection, a resurrection that brought us closer to God, a resurrection that has given us access to his infinite mercy, to his blessings, to his power, to his Holy Spirit. Let's remember that now, since it is finished, we that believe and are called his children have no fear, no condemnation, no lack, for we are perfect in him. He is alive.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah.
So I have. Now I open the floor for questions. Anyone has a testimony, prayer request? Man, tough crowd.
Pastor,
yes. Coincidental timing. Yeah. But anyone else?
here. I'm on my own. I'm out of that structured living after 6 months, and I think God's really, really been good to me. I never realized how many people out there care, and the prayers Wednesday night really helped me. Pastor Nathan's been good to me. I know I'm in the right place here where God wants me, and just keep praying for me, because I have that colonoscopy Tuesday, and that's no fun, but it could be a lot worse.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on that liquid diet today and tomorrow. That's the worst part. It'll be good.
I would like to ask prayer for my brother. He just moved to San Antonio, Texas. I pray that the Lord guides him to where he's supposed to be, that he finds a church that will embrace him as I have been embraced in this church, and he has access to the same blessings that I have had. For my sister that's coming here this summer, that she is touched by the Holy Spirit and has revelation, and she comes closer to God. And continue prayer for my wife and our situation, because some tough times are coming ahead, and I know that God, it's guiding my steps for whatever's coming.
Yes, amen.
Yes, James.
Well, pray for me. I'm dealing with a health situation. I don't know. I'm hoping to get my health restructured. Whoever steps forward, whoever I can get into a living arrangement so I can get reorganized next year. I'm hoping to do that. And also for Jack Aspengren, that's had liver cancer and it hasn't spread on him. I'm so thankful. He's such a believer. And we didn't realize he was in the hospital. He told me he was in the hospital that day. I didn't get to go out with him. We'll still be, I'll probably see him Sunday here. But good brother, and you know, John and Sheila for years, and lift him up and give him an encouraging word and words of kindness. It's a blessing in you also. So.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Yes, Joey.
I'll just ask for prayer for all of us, that we stay strong through anything the enemy tries to throw at us, whether it be in life or death or whatever it is. Keep us strong, because we are the army, and we need to keep pressing forward through these times. So, strength for all of us.
Amen.
Cindy.
Yeah, I'd like to ask prayer for a friend of mine. Her name is Cassetta. Her grandmother has been diagnosed with pancreas cancer. And cancer sure seems to be a theme that the enemy's raising on people. But I just stand in for healing.
Yes.
And also, Cassetta used to serve the Lord, and she's walked away. And one of the last conversations we had was when my youngest daughter was a teenager, and all the kids were fighting, and I took them to church. I said, we're staying here and, you know, praying until this is done. And I remember this Cassetta saying, this is too hard. It's too hard to serve God. I said, it's too hard not to serve God. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, I'm just believing this. God will use this to bring her back to Him.
Amen.
As well.
Amen.
Yes, Tim.
Yes, I just want to thank the Lord for the blessing He gives us, like, throughout the week and every day.
Yes.
You know, and we was at Walmart the other day, and it's just little things, like they had a product that was reduced, but when it rang up the register, it rang up the original price, and we told them that it had them on that shelf was that price, and they just said, you can go back and check if you want, and then they just went ahead and gave us the discount price on it, and it was like $10 off. And I thank the Lord for those type of things, because sometimes we don't always see the Lord in those things, but that was a blessing to us.
Oh, yeah.
And also, we just want to thank the Lord, just continue to pray for the situation with Bibiana and the family issues. And then one thing I always think about Easter Sunday is that it looked pretty sad on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
But the glory happened on Sunday.
Yes.
And everything mattered on Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Everything mattered. And one thing I think is just that always gives me, you know, it's just when He's crucified and going through the pain, you know, some was still down there mocking Him through all that, you know, and he realizes that the victory was already won when he was in Gethsemane
Wednesday night. Pastor was gone then also because of that sickness going around, and him and Sally have been passing it back and forth. So for their healing also, but for those that came, stepped forth and just spent a time in prayer, just going after God, it was an awesome time, and I thank each and every one that participated Wednesday night. Everyone that came here was part of what God was doing last Wednesday night, and I really want to thank them for that. And there's more to come. There's more to come. Thank you, Lord.
Going once, going twice. All right, let's stand. Tough crowd today. All right. Father, we thank you for bringing us together in your presence today. We thank you, Father, for the ultimate sacrifice, the cross, sending your only Son to die for us. But today we celebrate, Father, that he was resurrected from the dead, as the scriptures say. Father, thank you for giving us this wonderful gift, for giving us access to your infinite blessings, your mercy, Lord. Everything has been finished by that ultimate sacrifice. Father, we bring forth all of those that are not here right now, that are in need of your comfort, that are in need of healing, of breakthrough, of some relationship. And Lord, we put them in your hands right now, Father. And we thank you, Lord. We bless you, Father. We worship you. We praise you. We believe in your word, Lord. We thank you, Father. And today we celebrate. Thank you, Lord, for giving us your word, a word that is a sword for us to go out into this world and face whatever it is that the enemy is throwing against us.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Father, for giving us the strength, the confidence, the knowing that we are never alone, for you always walk with us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the things that you reveal to us, for the things that we do not understand, but that we know that are following your plan. Continue, Lord, to guide our steps, that we end up where you want us to go, Lord, so that your glory is magnified and your worth is brought forth unto those that are in need of hearing your word, that are looking for answers for something that we know, Father, that you are the only answer for those questions that are being asked. Thank you, Father, for what you're doing in this church, for the glory that is going to continue to grow and magnify this church, your mighty name. Thank you for those that you are calling. We declare right now that they will answer your calling, Lord, and they will come to you. And you will continue to be glorified and magnified. Thank you, Father. Thank you for looking into our hearts, for looking into our lives and seeing nothing wrong. Risen?
Yes, he has.
All right. Announcements. This coming Friday, we have our Eastern Gate House of Prayer. And Mike, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, we're going to endeavor like we did last month, but still on that same track. Yeah, we're going to do some worship, just lift up his voice and praise and worship him. But we're going to focus on this church, the people that he's calling to this church from the north, the south, the east, and the west, for this city, for this region, for our government, for Israel.
Yes.
Go on and on and on and on. Last trip through, we went downstairs, we prayed over the children's ministry, over the worship ministry, over the media ministry, naturally for the pastors and those in staff, and for those who are coming, and to minister and disciple those who are here.
Yes.
Okay? If we don't disciple, then we have one leader and a bunch of troops. The Lord is raising leaders.
Yes.
And in those times of praying, I hear the leader's voices coming forth. So focus on him. Hallelujah.
All right. Okay, well, let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of the servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to mix it up a little bit today. Jody and John, would you mind taking the offering? Can you say the blessing, please?
We will rejoice and be glad in it, God.
Yes, Lord.
You are our risen King, Lord, the one that we put all of our strength and our focus on, God.
Yes, Lord.
We put our spiritual eyes on you, Lord, because we know, God, that you are the maker of all things. We just thank you right now, God. We praise you, Lord. We give you this day, God.
All of it, Lord.
Yes, Jesus. Yes. We just pray, God, that you will bless this offering and the people that are here today. To hear your word and seek your truth, God, because we know that you are on the throne. We just praise you and love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. James. Hallelujah. Traveling mercies for those that aren't here today. Thinking of Mark and Zach. I'll just speak it in the atmosphere. There's still two more microphones for another alto and another soprano. As the Lord leads. Some of the youth that I've been working with, I know the Lord's up to something in that realm. Maybe one of them, or both of them, or several of them will be coming here. I don't know yet. As the Lord leads. But a soprano and an alto. I already hear their voices. Suzanne and Tammy do an awesome job, and they've been multitasking. It's hard playing a bass and singing. You know, it's worse than the rubbing, patting the head and rubbing the tubbing thing.
Way harder.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Suzanne. And then she gets to preach too. Hallelujah.
No pressure.
You got it? There you go. That's the answer I was looking for.
I open my ears and open my mouth.
Hallelujah. 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 Well, he's risen, church. I just want to celebrate. I just want to love on him. I just want to glorify and magnify his holy name. For he alone is worthy.
Yes,
so let's
Lord.
Get up on your feet.
Glory. Thank you, Jesus.
Can you unmute me, Myron?
Mike Christ. Mike.
Ready for some drum clicks, some stick clicks.
I'm waiting. My guitar is muted. There it is.
There it is.
Thank you. Hallelujah. I had to drag this out from underneath the bed. Since Zach's gone, I have to get my garage band stuff out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Stick
clicks. Yeah. Hallelujah, Lord.
Happy day, you'll never be the same. Oh, happy day. We will dance together in the city of our God.
Go right and forth.
Glory, Just tell him you love him, church. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. King of Lord and Lords. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy. You are the Alpha and the Omega, Lord. You are the beginning and the end. There is none like you, Lord. You alone are worthy, Lord. You alone are worthy, 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 Lord.
Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Holy Father, we love you. Jesus, we thank you that you came, Lord, in our place for us, Lord, and gave it all. Lord, you redeemed us. You stole us out of the pit. You conquered death, hell, and the grave forever. Oh, and you rose again, transformed in resurrection life. Oh, hallelujah, that same spirit you sent to dwell in our hearts, that very same spirit that rose you from the grave, now lives and breathes and moves and have its home in us. Oh, that we might know you and be like you, Lord. That we might know you and be like you, Lord. Oh, that is our heart's desire, Lord, to know you and to be like you. This morning we lift you up, Jesus. We thank you that you finished it on the cross. You finished it on the cross. The work that was to be done in this world to reconcile us to God is finished. If we will just believe and receive the free gift of grace, then we become joint heirs with you. Kings and priests in this world, Lord, fit, formed, chosen to usher in a new age of the kingdom of God on this earth. Chosen, hand-picked. Thank you, Lord, that you don't make mistakes. That it's no mistake that each and every one of us here today were hand-picked by you to carry forth your message of resurrection life, of reconciliation with God and peace and love in the Holy Ghost. Be with us this morning, Lord. Continue to do your work in this place, in the hearts of your people, as we celebrate that you are risen and alive forevermore. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Myself a little worked up. All right, thank you, worship team. Praise the Lord. What a joy to come into his presence and worship together with fellow saints. And all the children that are here today can be dismissed. And let's pray for Jamie this morning. Praise the Lord. Welcome to all the new faces. Happy Easter. He is risen. I am not the pastor here, so first let me begin by saying, our pastor's wonderful. I am simply trying to come with a message today. And as Mike was giving me a hard time before worship, you got it, right? No, I don't got it. But I have an ear, and I can hear, and I have a mouth, and I can speak. So I pray that what the Lord has put on my heart is what you all need to hear today, in Jesus' name. All right, so in tune with what our pastor usually does, I did not prepare a traditional Easter message, so if you came to hear about the cross and he's risen, then I'll direct you to the Gospels. They do an excellent job. But we are going to talk about what comes next.
Yes.
Jesus came. When he rose again, he came and he died so that we could have access to something more. So we could have something more in this life. And that is the kingdom of God, the very kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. And he opened a door. And when he opens a door, no man can shut it. So that naturally leads me to the Old Testament, to the book of Joshua. I want to talk about Joshua this morning. When we were in prayer Wednesday, there were two things that really spoke to my heart that I just couldn't shake as I got the call Thursday morning. He said, I want to renew your hope. There were people here Wednesday night that need renewed hope. So if any of you are here today that are weary, that need some renewed hope, I hope that you'll be encouraged today. And he said something so clear at the end as I was walking out, I said to Mike, we have crossed over. We have crossed over from the old into the new. So let us walk in the new. Amen. And so we have crossed over from death to life, from defeat to victory, from Adam to Jesus, and from the desert to the promised land. So on Easter Sunday, let's go to the Old Testament and open Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 through 16. This is our first introduction into Joshua. Exodus 17, 8 through 16. I'm going to do a lot of scripture, and I'm going to try to go really fast and hold my tongue till I'm done with all the scripture, because there's a lot of things I want to kind of talk about. It's going to be hard, but I'll try to keep the commentary to a minimum. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand up on the top of the hill with the rod of God in mine hand. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses and Aaron and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of his sword. And the Lord said unto Moses, write this for memorial in a book, and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. For I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. For he said, because the Lord hath sworn that the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. This is the Bible's first account of Joshua. He led the attack against the Amalekites. And in Exodus 17:13, the Amplified Bible translation says that Joshua mowed down and disabled the Amalek and all of his people. And it's shortly after this that Joshua becomes Moses' first assistant, his vice president, so to speak. And so I was curious, and I did some research about Joshua. And actually, his name was Hosea this time. His name didn't become Joshua until later on in the account in Numbers 13 and 14. And let's go to Numbers 13, 1 through 2. And then we're going to go to 17 through 33. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, send thou men, that thou mayest search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers shall ye send a man, every one a ruler among them. And 17 through 33, this is, maybe I'll summarize a little bit. This is where they send the spies out into Canaan. Moses is ready to go look and see, what is this land that God has promised us? And so he sends the spies out. And Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan, and said unto them, get you up this way southward, and go up into the mountain, and see the land, what it is, and the people that dwelleth therein, whether they be strong or weak or few or many, and what the land is that they dwelled in, whether it be good or bad, and what cities they be that they dwell in, whether in tents or in strongholds, and what the land is, whether it be fat or lean, whether there be wooden therein or not, and be ye of good courage, and bring the fruit of the land. Now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes. So they went up and searched the land from the wilderness of Zin unto Rehob, as men came to Hamath. And they ascended by the south, and came unto Hebron. Okay, let's skip forward a little bit. next screen. Keep going. And they told them and said, we came into the land that thou sent us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. It was one vine of grapes that it took two men to carry on a rod. That's how big the fruit was in the land.
Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. And the Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. But the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go up against this people, for they are stronger than we are. And they brought an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. They're giants. And there we saw giants, the sons of Anak, who come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. So this is our first glimpse, and this is when Moses, in some of the rabbinical kind of historical logs, say that this is when Moses saw that they were going to get a bad report. And so he changed Hosea's name to Joshua from saves to God saves, trying to give Joshua a little more influence with the people. But this is the first glimpse we have into the heart and the character of Joshua. He believed. He believed and he trusted the promises of God more than what he had seen with his own eyes. He saw the giants. He saw the mountains. He saw the great walled cities, but he was not moved by what he had seen. He was moved by what God promised. And that is why it was Joshua, this new warrior spiritual leader, that was selected to lead the Israelites into the promised land. So let's go to Deuteronomy 3, 23 through 28. Because up until this time, Moses had been a spiritual leader. He had just, you know, they were in the desert for, you know, for all that time, and he was their spiritual leader. They had no need. He had Joshua to go fight battles for him. And so, Deuteronomy 3, 23 through 28. And I besought the Lord at that time, saying, O Lord God, thou hast begun to show thy servant thy greatness and thy mighty hand, for what God is there in heaven or in earth that can do according to thy works and according to thy might? I pray thee, let me go. This is Moses speaking, by the way. I pray thee, let me go over and see the good land that is beyond Jordan, that goodly mountain in Lebanon. But the Lord was wroth with me for your sakes, and would not hear me. And the Lord said unto me, let it suffice thee, speak no more of me unto this matter. Get thee up into the top of Pisgah, and lift up thine eyes westward, and northward, and southward, and eastward, and behold it with thine eyes, for thou shalt not go over its Jordan. But charge Joshua, and encourage him, and strengthen him, for he shall go over before this people, and he shall cause them to inherit the land which thou shalt see. Moses wasn't allowed. He smote the rock when God said, speak to it.
Right.
Dean and I were talking. If we don't understand God, that seems extremely harsh. Why? One mistake. Moses did all of those things, led the people in exodus of millions, defied Pharaoh in the name of God. But one thing he did. But God said it would be this. And it can't be any other way.
Right.
He can't make allowance for one right. and not the other. He wouldn't be God. His word must be true. Mm-hmm. He cannot be a liar.
Right.
Moses would have made him a liar. Mm-hmm. It's not that he's harsh. It is that he is. It is that it is. Moses was not allowed to enter into the promised land. Instead, Moses was told to encourage and strengthen Joshua so he would be ready when it was his time to lead people across the River Jordan into the promised land. That had to have grieved Moses' heart. All those, I mean, just to see it, go to the top of the mountain, that's all you get is a glimpse. Mm-hmm. But here's the one. Teach him, be kind to him, encourage him, strengthen him, for he's going to continue on what I'm not allowing you to do. So let's go to Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all thou's people, unto the land which I do give to them, even the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and under the great sea toward the going down of the sun shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. Be strong and of good courage, Jody. That was your prayer request today. God has heard. Mm-hmm. Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right or to the left, that thou mayest prosper wherever thou goest. Once Moses died, the Lord wasted no time moving forward with this plan.
Right.
As soon as the Lord spoke to Joshua, he addressed the people, "Get ready, pack your bags. In 3 days, we're crossing the river into the promised land." And the first order of business once they crossed the river Jordan was the great walled city of Jericho. So Joshua sent spies to see what lay ahead for his people. And as they entered, the two spies entered the city of Jericho. They came into a woman's home, a harlot named Rahab. She takes them in, hides them from the king and his spies, and gives them the inside scoop on what's going on in Jericho and throughout the land. Joshua chapter 2, verses 1 and then 9 through 11. And Joshua the son of Nun sent out of Shittim two men to spy secretly, saying, "Go view the land, even Jericho." And they went and came into an harlot's house named Rahab and lodged there, verses 9 through 11. And she said unto the men, "I know that the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you, and when you came out of Egypt, and what ye did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side, Jordan, Sino, and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in earth beneath." What? These walled cities with these fancy kings were terrified of these people who had been in the desert for 40 years. I was thinking, what weapons did they have? What kind of armor did they have? Did they have chariots and horses? I don't read anywhere if they had chariots. No, they had an ark with the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
And the kings and the powerful leaders in the walled city shook in terror. They were afraid of this recent slave nation that had been wandering the desert for 40 years.
Yes.
It isn't the Israelites they fear. It's their God.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And after 3 days, the spies returned, and they gave a good report. Joshua chapter 2, verses 23 through 24. There weren't any of them left from when the bad report came. Moses stayed in the desert for 40 years, and not one of those men who believed the bad report entered the promised land.
Right.
This is a new generation.
Right.
This is a whole new generation who had been born in the desert, had been raised on God's provision, and who had listened to the word of their leaders. So the men who returned and descended from the mountain and passed over and came to Joshua the son of Nun and told them all the things that befell them. And they said unto Joshua, "Truly the Lord hath delivered into our hands all the land, for even all the inhabitants of the country do faint because of us."
Hallelujah.
So now the time has come. They prepare the ark, they prepare the people and the nation of Israel to cross the River Jordan into the promised land. Joshua chapter 3, verses 5 through 11. And Joshua said unto the people, "Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." And Joshua spake unto the priests, saying, "Take up the ark of the covenant and pass over before the people." And they took up the ark of the covenant and went before the people. And the Lord said unto Joshua, "This day will I begin to magnify thee in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that it is I, that as I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. And thou shalt command the priests that bear the ark of the covenant, saying, when ye are come to the brink of the water of Jordan, ye shall stand still in the Jordan." And Joshua said unto the children of Israel, "Come hither, hear the words of the Lord your God." And Joshua said, "Hereby ye shall know that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out from before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Havites, the Perizzites, the Gargashites, and the Amorites, and the Ites, and the Jebusites, and all the Ites, all the stuff. Behold, the ark of the covenant of the Lord of all the earth passes over before you into the Jordan." Let's go to 14 through 17, 3, 14 through 17. "And it came to pass, when the people removed from their tents to pass over Jordan, and the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the people, and as they that bear the ark were coming into Jordan, that the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped into the brim of the water, the Jordan overfloweth all his banks at the time of the harvest." So they weren't even at the banks yet. They were just at the tippies where it was kind of over. "That the water which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap very far from the city of Adam, that is beside Zaratan, and those that came down towards the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jericho. And the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan, and all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people were passed clean over the Jordan." Let's go to chapter 4, verses 14 through 18. "So the ark of the covenant and all of the people passed over on dry ground. Not even the tip of their, no mud, no wet hems, all the way back to Adam." It's no coincidence that city is named Adam. "And on that day, the Lord magnified Joshua in the sight of all Israel, and they feared him as they had feared Moses all the days of his life. And the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, Command the priest that bears the ark of the testimony that thou come up out of the Jordan. And Joshua therefore commanded the priest, saying, Come up out of Jordan. And it came to pass, when the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord were come up out of the midst of the Jordan, and the soles of the priest's feet were lifted up unto dry land, that the waters of Jordan returned unto their place and flowed over all his bank as they had done before. What will our God not do for us? What will our God not do for us? You think that the kings and leaders of Canaan were worried before? You think the king of Jericho was having a fit before? They just walked over and he stacked up a river until all of those people crossed. Right in front of their great walled city.
Yes.
Now word was getting out what God had done again. Joshua 5, 1. I'm sorry, 5, chapter 1. Yeah, Joshua 5, 1. That's okay. We're not to the corn. "And it came to pass, when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side of Jordan westward, and all the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Israel, until we were passed over, that their heart melted. Neither was their spirit in any of them anymore because of the children of Israel." So they're on the banks. They'd crossed over. The next order of business was to prepare for battle. So what does the Lord do? He has Joshua circumcise all of his warriors. Now, I don't know much about battle, but that doesn't seem like a very logical step to prepare for battle. But to the Lord, it's essential because he commanded it. All of the men of the nation Israel were to be circumcised. And these were young men who had been born in the desert. They weren't doing that in the desert. So before they took one more step in the name of the Lord, circumcision. Okay, that's an odd way to prepare for battle. Okay, so they healed, and then they were finally ready for battle. And then the Lord lays out his master battle plan. Joshua chapter 6, 2 through 5. "And the Lord said unto Joshua, See, I have given unto thine hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor. And ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go round about the city once. Thus shalt do that for 6 days." You'll walk around the city for 6 days. "And the 7 priests shall bear before the ark 7 trumpets of ram's horns. And the 7th day ye shall compass the city 7 times. And the priests shall blow with the trumpets. And it shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all of the people shall shout with a great shout, and this wall of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up, every man straight before him. That's the battle plan. The warriors are to follow the ark and walk once around the city for 6 days. On the seventh day, they walk around seven times. And then they blow the trumpet, and then they yell really loud. And God does something miraculous. Did any one of those have any doubt who brought down the wall? Who brought down that wall? Was it their really good marching? Was it the blast of the trumpet? The shout of victory? It was God. Do we have any doubt of what God will do? But Joshua knows that there is more going on than meets the eye. In Joshua chapter 5, verses 13 through 15, he had a visitor. Yeah, Joshua 5, 13 through 15. And it came to pass, when Joshua was by Jericho, that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, Art thou for us or for our adversaries? And he said, Nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, What saith my Lord unto the servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, Loose thy shoes off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. Joshua knew there were things going on that he couldn't see. How often do we forget? There's things going on that we can't see. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. So the people, they obeyed Joshua. And on the seventh day, victory. Joshua chapter 6. Verses 15 through 16. And the captain, is that right? And it came to pass on the seventh day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and compassed the city after the same manner seven times. Only on that day they compassed the city seven times. And it came to pass at the seventh time when the priests blew the trumpets, Joshua said unto the people, Shout, for the Lord hath given you the city. Verses 20 through 21. 6, 20 through 21. So the people shouted when the priests blew the trumpets, and it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, ox and sheep and ass, with the edge of the sword. Utterly destroyed. Utterly destroyed the enemy. Nothing left. And for the sake of time, I'm going to fast forward to chapter 10. I know, right? A lot of scripture, I told you. I'll get there. I promise. I'm getting there. I don't know if people know the story, so I want to make sure that we all know the story before I get there. Okay. So Joshua had taken and destroyed the city of Ai and was now joined by the inhabitants in the city of Gibeon had surrendered and joined forces with them. And they had made peace with Israel. So of course, once they make peace, then what happens? Well, of course, then the five kings join together. They're like, hey, let's join arms. This is getting crazy. They're taking over. They can't be five of us at once. Oh, yes, they can. Joshua 10, 5 through 10. The five Amorite kings joined forces to fight the Israelites at the city of Gibeon. And they utterly destroyed all that was in this... Oh, I'm sorry. 5:10, yeah. Therefore, the five kings of the Amorites, the king of Jerusalem, the king of Hebron, the king of Jarmuth, the king of Lachish, the king of Eglon, gathered themselves together and went up, they, all their hosts, and encamped before Gibeon and made war against it. And the men of Gibeon sent unto Joshua to camp... to Gilgal, saying, Slack not thy hand from thy servants. Come up to us quickly, and save us, and help us. For all the kings of the Amorites that dwell in the mountains are gathered together against us. So Joshua ascended from Gilgal, he and all the people of war with him, and all the mighty men of valor. And the Lord said unto Joshua, Fear them not, for I have delivered them into thine hand. there shall not a man of them stand before thee. Joshua therefore came unto them suddenly and went up from Gilgal all night, and the Lord discomforted, utterly destroyed them before Israel, and slew them with a great slaughter at Gibeon, and chased them along the way that goeth up from Bethhoron, and smote them unto this other city. Victory was at hand, but Joshua wasn't finished. He wanted this done once for all. He had the five kings on the run, and they were found. They were found. So he said, he commanded the sun and the moon to stop. He commanded. The Lord didn't tell him to command. He commanded. He said, stop. And the sun and the moon stopped. Joshua 10, 11 through 14. And it came to pass, as they fled from before Israel and were in the going down to Bethoron, that the Lord cast down great stones from heaven upon them unto Azekah, and they died. They were more which died of the hailstones than they whom the children of Israel slew with the sword. And then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel, and he said in the sight of Israel, sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon, in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Joshua? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and hastened not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it, or after it, that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. So the five kings were on the run, and they were found in a cave. And Joshua said, roll a stone, cover that cave, and trap them. So he went about and took care of the rest of the armies and made an end of slaying them with a great slaughter. And then Joshua called for the five kings to be brought to him, and they were slain. He hung them. There's so many symbols and types and shadows in the story of Joshua. The entire story of Moses to Joshua is a strong foreshadowing of the life of Christ. Jesus was transformed from just a spiritual leader when he walked before the cross into a warrior leader after his resurrection. Through his resurrection, he was so completely transformed that his closest followers didn't even recognize him. And I can't help but think of the pictures Roberto shared about what we look like going into prayer as a kitty cat and us coming out of prayer as a lion. That is exactly the picture that the Father is painting from Moses to Joshua, and from Jesus before and after his resurrection, the lion and the lamb. Isaiah 53, 2 through 3. Jesus, the lamb. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath nor form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. To Revelation chapter 19, 11 through 16. This is the transformation. This is what resurrection power does to every person it touches. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he does make judgment and make war. His eyes were a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed in a vesture dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. A very different picture. That is the God we serve. That is resurrection power alive in Jesus Christ, warrior king.
Yes.
To know him and to be like him. The book of Joshua shows us how God handed over the promised land to the Israelites. We should take note of the battle plans. As it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end, and it is still the same today. Only now our promised land is not a physical territory on this earth. It's the very kingdom of heaven. And the promised land gives us access to houses we did not build, eating fruit from vines we did not plant. This is the kingdom of God. And Jesus opened the door for us to enter the kingdom of God. And whatever door he opens, no man can shut it. So just as Joshua led the Israelites across the River Jordan into the promised land, we must also cross over that River Jordan and enter into the promised land. And this is something I've shared before, but I had a vision, and I was carrying Craig, and I was running towards a river, and I had these like things on me. They were whatever they were, disease, sickness, impurity, sin, whatever it was. And I was running towards this river. I knew I had to get in the river, get in the river, get in the river. And I got there. And so I had to hand Jesus to, Jesus was there on the cross on one side, and I gave Craig to him. And then I went into the river. And as I went to the river, these things started to come off. Some of them didn't even want to touch the river. Some of them climbed higher not to try and get in the river. And then I was submerged to my shoulders in the river, and there was this one left, and it was on my head. And it was trying to cover my eyes and put his fingers in my ears and to distract me. And I knew I had to go all the way under the water. Mm-hmm. And so I went all the way under the water, and I'm holding my breath. And I'm realizing that as long as I'm holding my breath, this thing is holding his breath. So I knew in that moment I had to make a choice to give it up, give up the ghost, so to speak, let it go, and let God. And trust that it was going to be all right. And the minute I just let go and gave up the ghost, I was outside of myself on the other side of the river watching as I rose from the river in my magic robe, sparkling white robe, hands lifted, praising God, righteous, in that white robe that he had given me.
Yep.
And I was shocked. And I looked at Jesus, and he was smiling at me, and Craig was smiling at me, and I opened my eyes, and Craig had that same smile on his face. He was three. And I knew that he was seeing the exact same thing that I was seeing.
Yeah.
We are a new creation.
Yes.
We are born again. We are transformed.
Yes.
All he sees is that magic coat, right? I call it that magic coat, that white coat, our robe of righteousness, white linen, righteous.
Yes.
That's all God sees.
Yes.
And I couldn't take Craig. I couldn't bring him with me. He has to make that own choice for himself.
Right.
But he needs to see what it looks like to live a life of resurrection power, so he knows
right.
that it's okay to get in the water.
Right.
That you can trust God.
Yes.
That God is faithful, and God
yes.
will rise you up in power you never dreamed.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, death, where is thy victory?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, grave, where is thy sting?
Mm-hmm.
And what is this river? I can't help but think of Ezekiel 47. Nathan prophesied about that river.
Mm-hmm.
It starts at the temple of God. And it flows to our ankles,
mm-hmm.
it flows to our knees, it flows to our shoulders until we can't even swim it.
No.
We're not intended to swim it.
No.
We rise from it, victorious.
Yes.
Tammy just talked about that last Sunday. We rise from it.
Yes.
We float, we refreshed, we recreation on our little inner tubes in the river when we need some time to soak and relax.
Yes.
But we rise from that river victorious.
Yes.
We are the headwaters of that very living water that Jesus spoke about. There's rivers of living water flowing from every one of us.
Yes.
That river of God comes
yes.
through us into this world. We are
yes.
the outlets.
Yes.
We are what brings it forth.
Yes.
And in Revelation 22:1, there's a river in the kingdom of God where all life flows. The tree of life is planted on it.
Yes.
And when we reach the edge, we cross over, and we see those walled cities. Do any of you have any walled cities in your life? Cancer, disease, sickness, poverty, divorce, relationships. Those are the ites. Those are the walled cities in our life. But they are nothing compared to the resurrection power of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We have been promised that where our feet go, we will possess the land. We have a firm foundation, a promise that we will be victorious.
Yes.
That God that we serve, that sword of truth, We'll slay whatever enemies are in our path if we will just believe.
Yes.
And so, how many times have we heard stories of God's battle plans for us?
Mm-hmm.
The Lord works in mysterious ways. I was praying for Sheila, and I called her. I said, Sheila, walk around your house 3 times and anoint it with oil.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Dawn, you had Jane stand on a Bible.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. God uses. Nathan walked a bike trail for a year. Walked a bike trail. Sometimes you got to keep walking. Sometimes you got to keep saying and speaking the word. Sometimes you got to shout. Sometimes you got to blow the trumpet.
Yeah.
But God will lead you and guide you. He will tell you what brings down that wall.
Yes.
And if you don't know, then you stand and you say, stop, son. I'm done. We're going to finish this.
Yes.
And God will hear you.
Come on.
God will hear you. Jesus said, peace be still to the oceans.
Yep.
Peace be still to the oceans. Joshua. Sun, stop. Moon, stop for a day. Whatever you need, God has provided.
Yes.
We must show no mercy to our enemy. He is roaming around looking to devour us, looking to discourage us, looking to get us to look at anything but God.
Right.
What can they do? What can this world do? What is left? It's us. We must believe. We must trust God, and we must show the enemy no mercy. We must utterly destroy the doubts that come into our own mind. And how do we renew our mind? By the word of God.
Yes.
By hearing the word of God, the testimonies
yes.
of God's grace and his mercy and his goodness. We come together. We link arms.
Mm-hmm.
When we pray in this house, when those gather and pray, that is warfare
yes.
of the utmost powerful kind.
Yes.
Pray. Seek God's face, speak his word, worship God.
Yes.
That is how we possess the land.
Yes.
We wrestle not against principalities and powers.
Mm-hmm.
We put on the full armor of God.
That's right.
And having done all, you just stand.
Right.
Do not be pushed and moved. You are seated with heavenly places. There's a scripture that I didn't read from Joshua, but when he has those kings brought to him, he says, bring me those kings. Come here, my mighty warriors. You stand on their necks. Put your feet on the neck.
Mm-hmm.
That is what God thinks of our enemies. You put your foot on the neck. You are seated in heavenly places far above every principality and power.
Yes.
You put your foot on the neck.
Yep.
Yes.
And he makes your enemies a footstool.
Yes.
Satan is under your feet.
Yes.
Right.
When you've done all, you stand.
Yep.
God is, Jesus said, I've given you power to tread on serpents. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. In this world you will have tribulation, but fear not. I have overcome the world.
Yeah, yeah.
This is how we glorify God. This is how we bring the kingdom of heaven to earth.
Yes.
We believe his word. We trust God will lead us in victory. And we follow after the leading and guidance of the Holy Spirit one step at a time.
Yes.
That's all he asks. One step of faith. One step. I am with you every moment of every day. Just trust me. Ask me. I will show you. I will give you the next step, the next word. I will bring that person to speak so you hear.
Right. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
That is how. Just watch what God will do.
Mm-hmm.
So to wrap up this morning, I'm going to paraphrase what the Lord is saying to you this morning. This is the book of Joshua 1 through 7. But this is God speaking to you, saying the exact same thing he told Joshua, for you are to possess the land. The old man is dead. Get going. Cross the River Jordan, you and all your family. Cross to the country I'm giving you, to all the people in Christ. I'm giving you every square inch of the land you set your foot on, just as I promised Jesus. From the wilderness and this Lebanon east to the great river, the river Euphrates, all the Hittite country, as far as you can see. And then west to the great sea. It's all yours. All your life, no one will be able to hold out against you. In the same way I was with Jesus, I'm with you. I won't give up on you. I won't leave you. Strength and courage. You are going to lead the people in your family to inherit the land that I promised to give your ancestors.
Yes.
Give it everything you have, heart and soul. Make sure you carry the revelation that Jesus commanded you, every bit of it. Don't get off track, either left or right, so as to make sure you get where you're going. And don't for a minute let this book of the Revelation be out of your mind. Ponder it, meditate on it day and night. Make sure you practice everything written in it. Then you'll get where you're going, and then you'll succeed. Haven't I commanded you? Strength and courage. Don't be timid. Don't get discouraged. God, your God, is with you every step of the way.
Amen.
So God wants you to know he has opened the door to the kingdom of heaven. Now go and possess the land.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
All right. Praise the Lord. You are dismissed and happy Easter. In Jesus' name.
Amen.